Well, thank you for the nice introduction. Thank you for the nice pronunciation. So first, I would like to thank the Linux Foundation for inviting me here, especially despite the fact that 6 months ago, maybe, I was still thinking that the Linux Foundation was a bunch of students in the garage. And actually, I discovered in that the 6 months that it's not at all that. I mean, I've checked their revenues, and their growth is much higher than Orange, actually. So my background is in the radio access network. I've been doing that for the last 15 years with 3G, 4G, 5G. And open software is not the first part, let's say, in the network domain that has been changed. The radio access network is a bit behind some other domain. But we're coming in. To be honest, it's not really the first attempt. I remember that 15 years ago, there was a project that was called OpenBTS. OpenBTS goal was to implement the 2G protocol stacks in open source and in order to make it run over a PC. And actually, technically speaking, it worked, but it was really small scale. And what I want to explain today is that now we are going large scale in doing that in the for the radio access network with 5G. And in order to do so, we have created a main tool that is ORAN. So ORAN stands for Open RAN, of course. And Open RAN Alliance has been created 18 months ago with five operators, including Orange. There is AT&T for the US, of course. There is Orange and Deutsche Telekom, mainly for Europe and Africa. China Mobile, China. And NTT Docomo for Japan. And it was really important for us to create this alliance on a global basis, because it will be tough, to be honest, to open the RAN. The RAN, as I will explain today, is quite a closed world currently. And in order to succeed in that, we really need to be, let's say, global scale. So ORAN has been funded over two previous alliance and forum, the XRAN forum that was mainly Western oriented and the CRAN alliance that was mainly China oriented. So the success is quite good so far. So after like 1 year of practical operation, on top of the five founders, we have now 16 additional operators joining from all over the world. We have, of course, all the big US operators. We have now Korea joining. We have most of the European operators. We have all the Chinese operators. On top of this operator, we have 80, probably more now, but let's say more than 85 non-operator contributors. And these contributors are coming from different domains. Some are doing chipsets, for instance, like Intel or Broadcom. We have as well the big, large network vendors, such as Ericsson, for instance. But we have as well Nokia, ZTE, Cisco, and so on. We also have some subsystem provider, some guys doing hardware, because in order to have a good radio access network, you need radio. And radio is hardware. And so we have people creating some very nice power amplifier, active antennas, things like that coming, like KMW, for instance. And we also have some pure player of software or integrators, such as Mavenir or Redisys. So we have created really a very nice ecosystem already working a lot. So today, what I want to pass as a message is that it is really the good time to do so. So I said before that there were some attempts in the past, but they kept very small scale. And if we need now to go large scale, And there are really key reasons for that. So the first reason is about the services we want to enable with 5G. So on this slide, you can see two of the most important families of services that we will deliver. The first is immersive video like VR, AR, and the second family that is quite big actually is what we call usually the vertical application. So it is a set of services that is, let's say, dedicated to some specific sectors, and all of them have very specific requirements. But the common point of all these services is that most of the time they require very low latency. And this very low latency, I can tell you, is something that we cannot deliver with our current network. Our current architecture that has been created with 2G and that has not evolved, to be honest, so much from 2G to 3G to 4G. Of course, there were new functions, new names, and so on. But let's say the topology of the network has not changed that much. We will need to change that. It's a very big change because of the latency for, again, a very fundamental reason that we cannot change. It is the speed of light. To make it simple, the speed of light is 300,000 kilometers per second in the air. And it's a bit less in fiber. It's like 200,000 kilometers per second. So when saying that, we think that it's very quick, but actually it's not. Going back and forth at this speed, if you want to have 1 millisecond latency, you cannot go further than 100 kilometers. And it is the fundamental reason why we need to change the topology of the network, to change the position where we put the nodes, the application, the clouds, and so on. And this, we need to agree to some extent with the ecosystem about how to make this, because we don't want to do that differently. All the big operators have a lot of respect for the standards. And there is one reason for that. It is because the standards make our success. If we do something, let's say, separately, then we lose the economy of scale, and then we don't succeed. So the standards and now the open source are really key for the operator to change this architecture and to make it much more compact. There is another fundamental reason why we need to change now. It is what I call the sense of history. So looking at this example, you may know, if you are about my age, this small device. Actually, it's a gaming device. So it's something that 35 years ago, I think, we could buy. And it is a game with a specific hardware and with a specific software. So you buy a game, but at the same time, you buy hardware. So it's not very flexible. For some reason, we spent probably like hundreds of hours on that, but my child would not do that. Because my children, what they want to do is to be able to change, to have new games, and so on. And so during these 35 years, there were several changes to come to a situation where we have a total separation between the hardware, the platform, let's say, and the game. And it's very flexible. So currently, in the RAN domain, we are very close to the situation here. So if you can let me introduce where we are at the stage of what I call the traditional radio access network, which is here. It means that we buy some equipments that are closed. We mainly have two boxes. One box is the radio. We call it RRH, remote radio head. It is the, let's say, specialized hardware, power amplifier, receiver, converters, and so on. Something that is very analogic, to be honest. And another box that contains all the digital processing with the different layers. It is probably like 99% of the equipment that are deployed by the big operator. It is the current situation. And it is changing now to the model that we have here in the middle that we call virtualized. And the first change that we are doing is that we introduce a cloud infrastructure in the radio access network. And this cloud infrastructure is in charge of managing the higher layer of the digital processing, so what we call layer 3. So it's probably like 1% of the radio access equipment that we have. And the target that we are setting now is the disaggregated radio access network. So it's something that you may know in for some other network domains, but is now coming on the run. And in this model, most of the digital processing is supported in the cloud with different modules. And these modules can be either open source or proprietary. And you need a lot of, let's say, well-defined interface in order to run that properly. So just a quick view on the Open RAN architecture that you have here. So I will not describe all the box, of course. But let's say, roughly speaking, it is three parts. On the top, you have the network management system that is non-real time. And then you have what we call the CU, for centralized unit. So here, it is really the radio access network itself and the distributed unit. So the centralized unit is normally executed on an edge data center, and the distributed unit is normally very close to the antenna. So the Open RAN Alliance enable this. The Open RAN Alliance has created this overall architecture, and on top of creating the architecture, the Open RAN Alliance provide mainly two things. The first is open interface. It's very key to properly define the interfaces and the APIs. Because if you miss this point, if you create an interface that is not at the good place and is not well defined, what you will do is worse than having no standardization. Because then you may have, let's say, poor performances, and you may also jeopardize the evolution of your system. Because this interface, which is not correctly defined, then it will block the two parts on the two sides of the interface to evolve correctly. So we spend a lot of time in the alliance to properly define these interfaces. By the way, many of them are actually defined in 3GPP in the standard. So either they are defined in 3GPP and then the ORAN alliance creates some, let's say, profiles in order to make it easier to make it multi-vendor. Or either it does not exist in 3GPP and then it's totally created in the alliance. The second thing that is created in the ORAN domain, and I will explain after the way it is created, is of course open source modules. The radio access network currently, it is 90% closed. So we will not make it open source fully like next year. It will take time. So the good way to progress in this direction is to create open source module by module. So there are some modules that are easy to make open source, and we start with that. And with time, we will have more and more of open source. Maybe one specific driver that appears during the last weeks and months is about the fragmentation of the ecosystem. So I don't know if some of you have followed that, but there are some discussions, let's say, between the US and China. And these discussions are about trade and security. So what could happen at the end of this discussion? Nobody knows. I mean, maybe we will be exactly in the same, let's say, way of operation than today, in 2 years, or maybe it will be different. What could happen is that it could create some additional regulatory requirement that we will need to follow in the different countries. And sometimes this regulatory requirement, if you apply it to a closed system, then you have no choice. It is yes or no. If you apply it to an open system, then as an operator, you may have the choice to say, okay, this module, this regulatory requirement create this constraint, but this module is, let's say, more relaxed, and it's and then you can let's say source it with not too much issues. So if we want the ecosystem, despite this discussion, to stay really global, then this open RAN architecture could help a lot. So I said 18 months ago we have created the alliance, and more recently we have created the Open RAN software community that has been introduced already by the previous speaker. And the way we did that is to associate the ORAN Alliance with the Linux Foundation. And we thought a lot about that. Why doing that with the Linux Foundation? It is because in the RAN domain, we don't have such a big background, and the Linux Foundation was probably the best choice in order to be, let's say, to have a professional and global, large-scale way of, let's say, attracting the developer, providing the documentation, providing the testing and integration methodology, and manage the open source software as such. Of course, this Open RAN software community that is included inside the Linux Foundation is coordinated very tightly in order to make sure that the architecture that is defined in ORAN will be followed. So next big date for this OSC is November, where the first release, that is called Ember, of the software should be issued. And it will focus on what we call the Radio Intelligent Controller, that is in charge, as it it is said, of, let's say, controlling the radio network. Just one word about the challenge. So all that I have said is very, I mean, exciting, but in order to make it a success, we have many challenges, but among these many challenges, one of them is very tough, it's very high. It is about test and integration. So I can tell you, as an operator and as a RAN specialist, we have, of course, integrated the RAN with the core network, with all the environment, with different interfaces, the devices, and so on. But as operator, we have never really integrated the RAN itself, some inner interface of the RAN itself. And it is complex. We should not really underestimate this part. It is very complex. It could take a lot of time if you don't make sure you have the right methodology. And so what we are starting to do now is to understand how we can make that efficiently. So there are mainly two choices that you can make for this test and integration. So either you can go your own way, as Orange, we say, okay, I will set up a test and integration center that will be only for Orange, where I will ask the vendors and when I will put the open source module and integrators together, and they will make sure that it works at the end. And there is another way to do that. It is to discuss among the different operators, discuss with the vendors, discuss with the developers, and so on, and try to say, okay, in this test and integration, there are some things that we can factor, that we can make once for the whole ecosystem, and we can maybe create a multi-operator, multi-vendor, integrator, developer, and so on, some places where a large part of the test and integration will be done. And on top of that, of course, we will need a single operator integration at the end in order to make sure that in each and every of the countries that where we are operating, that the solution works. Of course, we have some validation integration to do. But probably you can make like 80% of the work that is common to several operators, and then 20% remaining that needs to be managed by each and every operator. So thank you. That is the end of my speech, and that is the break, by the way.